Hello and welcome to another exciting installment of Shelf Indulgence Book Club, where we discuss books, authors, and genres that don't normally get the book club treatment. So today we're going to discuss the wonderfully fun genre of Highlander Romance. And Highlander Romance is a Scottish-themed American romance type books. And I would say they either have Highlander or Scott in the title, so they're pretty easy to find. They are probably predominantly historical romances, although there are some that are modern now. And the other feature is their fun covers. They usually feature a buff man in a kilt, often bare-chested, and sometimes there's a lady, sometimes she has red hair, and the guy usually has some sort of tartan that goes along with his clan. Sometimes in the background you see the castles or craggy hills or grassy knolls with some heather or other purple flowers in it. So let's get into the different books that we read before we discuss any further. So I'm going to let Mallory tell us about what she read.
I like how you described one of the hallmarks of this genre being its book covers, because the one that I chose ticks all of those boxes. It is Hit Me With Your Best Scott by Suzanne Enoch. And this is the third in a series that I skipped to because I started reading the first two books in the series, which, by the way, is called The Wild Wicked Highlanders. And it follows, as many of them do, a family of, in this case, Highland Scotsmen. And it's three brothers, and each book in the series follows one of the brothers. And I didn't really like the younger two brothers. So as I was starting the series, which started with, what was the title of it? It's hilarious. It's Getting Scott in Here. Started with that one, follows the youngest brother, Neil. And he was a little too smarmy for me. So then I started the second one. It follows the bad boy brother, Aiden. And that one is called Scott Under the Covers. So it's a little more risque. Didn't like him too much. So I skipped to the only brother that appealed to me, Cole, who is the main character. And all these three books, they switch between, as romance novels often do, the hero, in this case, Cole McTaggart, and the woman that he is pursuing, Mrs. Persephone Jones. And this is a Regency era romance. So I love the Regency period, but when you get into these historical romances, you have to kind of suspend, if you're a fan of the Regency, you have to suspend some of your notions about the mores and the language that would happen in the Regency, because these are first and foremost romance books. So they say the F word a lot for the Regency period, which kind of surprised me. But overall, I had a really good time with this series, even though I was kind of like, sometimes with some of the dialogue and things like that. It has a good premise because Cole and his brothers are being forced into marriage by their mother. They are full of Scottish pride, but their mother is an English noblewoman. And she abandoned the sons and took her daughter back to England early in their childhoods. And before she left Scotland, she struck a deal with Angus McTaggart, the dad, because of course his name is Angus. She struck a deal with him that her sons would have to marry English women before her daughter was allowed to marry the man of her choice. So basically, the daughter gets to marry whoever she wants, but the sons have to marry English women before she's allowed to do so. So they have like 2 months to do this, and the two brothers get married off within the first month, basically. And then we come to Cole, the oldest, who's very brash and consistently described as a big hulking mountain of muscle and things like that. And he's like very straightforward. So all of these brothers follow different romantic archetypes for the hero role. And he is basically in panic mode because he has less than a month to find an English woman to marry, or else his sister can't get married, or his mother will cut off the Scottish side of the family from the estate because she holds the purse strings. So it actually also has some of the fake relationship trope because he quickly becomes enamored with an actress, Mrs. Persephone Jones. There was never a Mr. Jones. It's just a form of like maintaining respectability in the theater because it was such a risque profession for the time. And he scandalizes his mother by saying he's going to marry this actress. So there's a lot of like comedy of errors stuff going on and hidden identities and mistaken identities. There's also a murder subplot, and it actually ended up being like a really like good narrative compared to what I read of the first two books. So if you pick up a book in the Wild Wicked Highlander series by Suzanne Enoch, hit me with your best Scott, because he is the best Scott in my opinion. So anyways, what did you read, Stephanie?
So I read two books this time. I'm trying to keep up with Starr. So I read two by the same author. So the first one I read was Devil of the Highlands by Lindsay Sands. I thought this was like published in the 90s because of the cover, but it was published in 2009. So it follows Evelyn, who is betrothed to the Devil of the Highlands. His name is Cullen, by her evil stepmother. It kind of has like Cinderella vibes. So he like travels to her home. They get married like that night. It's a lot of like comedy of errors, like a lot of like crazy things like happen and, you know, while he's there, whatever. So they get married. He takes her back to his like homeland, and she finds out that all of these like nefarious things have like happened around like his Cullen's like uncle was killed, but they think it's an accident. And then his father is killed, and then his first wife is killed. And there's rumors like circulating that it's like Cullen is behind all of these like crazy things that are happening. So Evelyn searches for the answers, like tries to like figure out what's really happening. She doesn't believe that Cullen could do anything. Gets herself into a lot of trouble, and he has to save her, and then, you know, we figure out who is behind all of these crazy things. Then the second one, the cover's a little risque, I think, but Highland Wolf, also by Lindsay Sands. This was just published this year. So this follows Claret, who is about to be married off to some terrible man named McNaughton, and Connell, who is known as the Wolf, is sent by her father to save her. And on the way, he saves her, obviously. And then on the way back to her dad's house, they like fall in love, and we learn that Claret and Connell were actually betrothed as children, but everyone thinks that he died. Like no one knows that he's alive. We find out that his family was poisoned, like his entire clan was killed. And so his uncle like rushed him off and like saved him. And he's been working as a mercenary to save money to come back to his homeland and like get everything back up and running. This also has like Disney princess vibes. I think that's just like Lindsay Sands like kind of thing. She takes one of those stories and like turns it into a Highland romance. So it's kind of similar to, it's like a mystery, like Claret like tries to figure out what's really going on, like who killed Connell's family. And if they're still after him, it's a lot of comedy of errors. Again, I think that's just Lindsay Sands' whole vibe. But they were like fun and interesting. Like they were really light. I probably would have went down more of a rabbit hole with this one too. Like I would have read more had I not like stopped myself, because they're fun and interesting. So I didn't think I would like this genre, but I kind of do. Star.
Okay, so my first choice was Donna Fletcher, The Highlander's Bride. And don't really like the cover as much, but apparently it was the second in the Highlander duo series. And at the beginning, they must rehash what happened in book number one. This book also features Cullen, and he apparently fell in love with this woman, and her father was evil and didn't want them to be together and tried to keep them apart. But she ends up pregnant. So the father puts her in a convent until she gives birth and then wants the baby killed and puts Cullen in prison. And he apparently gets saved by this girl who was dressed up as like a young man who is now married to what he found as his half-brother. So the book opens up with Sarah. She is in a convent because her father wanted her to marry a laird, and he was smelly and stinky and gross and just rude, and she's like, hard pass. So he puts her in this convent to either, she has to agree to marry this guy or find another husband, and then she can come home. So it's been 2 years. And while she's been there, this girl came in and she was pregnant and she had the baby, and she was supposed to help get rid of the baby, and then she's the one that buried it in the cemetery. So she's there, she's in the chapel praying for a guy to come, because you don't really meet very many men in the convent, because she just wants to get out of here and come back home. And Cullen comes and he wants to know where his son is. And she's the only person that realizes that the son isn't dead, that she was able to get him away and tell everybody that the baby died and that she buried it. And he comes in and asks the head nun, you know, where's my son? And she's like, he's dead. There's the grave. And he doesn't really believe it. So he digs up the grave and finds that it's just, you know, like seed in a bag, and it's not a baby. And so she comes out and she's like, hey, your son's not dead. I saved him. I'm the only person that knows where he is. I'll take you to him, but you have to do something for me. We have to get married. And I don't really care what happens after that. We just need to get married, and then I'll take you to your son. We'll go to my house for a while until everybody believes we're fighting, because she was really tall and very opinionated, and you know, she figures nobody would want her anyways. And so they'll fight a little bit, and then he'll just disappear, and then she can live there in her home without anybody bothering him. She won't have to marry the smelly guy. And so he has to agree because he wants to find his son. And they, of course, on the journey to find his son, fall in love, and they have to get his son and stay away from the people that the girl's father is trying to get them and kill them all. So that was that book. There was no Gaelic dialect in that one, so I wanted to read one that was slightly different. So I read another one, Highland Bride by Hannah Howell. This one is apparently number 6 in the Murray family saga and number 1 in the McEnroy family. I guess they're starting a new family. And it starts off with Gillian, and she is a very small, or as they call a wee bonny lass. And she hasn't had any suitors. She's, you know, smart and but really small, and she sees all her cousins and everybody getting married and having kids, and while she is happy for them, it makes her sad. And so her uncle gives her some dower lands that are supposed to be for her husband when she gets married, and she decides, I'm just going to go there and see what it is, and that maybe I'll just stay and, you know, be my own laird. And so she travels out there with her cousin, and she likes the house and the land, and she thinks everything's great, and then here comes 3 lairds, and apparently there's 3 guys that own the lands all around her land. And they all decide that she has to marry one of them because they all want her land, and she has to pick one. And she's like, nah, I'm good. So they make a plan that they each have one day until sundown to try to convince her to pick them. And so they're all like kind of waiting out. Side. And the first guy comes, and she's kind of ready because somebody overheard their talking. and she brewed up some horrible stinky concoction. And when they're coming, they're all, her people are up on the wall, and they dump the smelly stuff on them, and it's so foul that they take their clothes off and they run away. And so the second guy comes the next day, and her plan is that they build like watchfires outside the wall, and when they see the people coming, the lads that are tending the fire drop bundles of herbs in there, and the smoke from that will put them to sleep. And she goes up on the wall and she's talking to them, and to make them stay long enough to breathe in the fumes, she sings. Apparently she sings like an angel, and they can't but stand and stare at her. And then they all pass out, and then they go out and take off all their clothes and their weapons, and they leave them out there naked. So the third guy's been watching this, and he's like, okay, they're all stupid and they're underestimating the wee Bonnie Lass. And so I'm not going to be fooled, but I have to go in there because I have to try. So she invites him in, and he's like, I know this is a trap. And she's like, no, it's fine. Here's a big meal. And she had put stuff in some of the food, and she knew which food that she should eat. And those guys all fall asleep, but they were prepared. They all wore like stuff underneath their clothes, and they left some of their weapons back at camp with some guys. So they still had stuff covering their bits and only lost part of a thing. And so she's trying to buy time until her father can get there, who's apparently a favorite of the king, who can like stop this nonsense. And he doesn't get there in time, and they basically come and say, you need to pick one or there's going to be bloodshed. And she doesn't want anybody that's in her lands and any people that live there to get in trouble. So she decides to pick guy number three. And so he whisks her off. He has a priest right there. They get married. He, on the way back to his castle, like kicks this old couple out of their cottage and beds her, and then takes her back. And then she falls in love with him, and she's trying to get him to admit that like he cares for her. And then there's like a murder and some other stuff going on with that one. But that one did have a lot of the, I kinda do that for ye, and you know, that kind of language, which was fun. I did read an article about this from a Scottish perspective, and they're basically kind of like, that's not really accurate dialogue. And if you were in the Highlands, like you couldn't go without a shirt, you'd be too cold even in the summer. And the historical references are usually mixed up, and it's not really accurate, but it's fun. That's why I think they said it's like an American thing.
Yeah.
I did look up my author, Suzanne Enoch, is from Southern California. So I was like, oh yeah, that tracks, because there's no way. One of my favorite things on the internet is Scottish Twitter. Yeah, they write the Scots language phonetically, and it's technically a different language altogether, basically, if you read it. And you really have to read it out loud, and then you're like, oh, that's what they're saying. And it's hilarious. Everybody should look at Scottish Twitter. But because this was so far even from that, and I couldn't like reconcile the fake brogue that they were doing with what I know of the actual like Scots language. So that I would say is my only qualm with this. I think I would have preferred it, Star, if I read a book like the first one you read that you said did not really have that.
No, it didn't have any of that in there. Luckily for mine, they pretty much reused the same words over and over again. You know, like I kinda or dunna or nay. And so after a while, it's the same grouping, kind of like in Amish fiction where they use the same words for like mother or pretty. And so you kind of get used to that little group of words. But yeah, at the beginning, it's hard.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mine, they're written by the same author, so obviously she would do the same thing, but she used the same words in both of them. But I actually listened to the audiobook because I wanted the full Scottish experience. Like I want someone with the accent to read it to me. But I also read along with it just to see, like, the words are obviously spelled different, like if I could actually figure out how to pronounce it without them saying it to me.
Was it a real Scottish person, do you think, reading, or was it somebody that was just putting the accent on?
I think so. I hope so.
There was stuff online when I searched that you could find Scottish men reading Scottish romance, which I didn't listen to, but I think that would be fun.
I think so too.
The first one The Devil of the Highlands, that one was narrated by a woman, and then Highland Wolf was narrated by a man, which is interesting.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So I also read that there's the heroines in the story, some of them are Scottish. In my books, they were both Scottish, but I've read some before where they're English. And of course, if it's the English woman, they're always more, I guess they're used a different way, and they're supposed to know the ways of court and correct manners and how to conduct yourself. And of course, they have to teach it to the laird, who's just a brute and doesn't know how he should act in different situations, which is fun.
That was the primary trope in this series, because the premise is that these Scottish brothers have to marry English women. And it is not, the drama really doesn't start in the way that I like it until the book that I read, where it's, he picks a woman who really does defy the social mores of the time because she's an actress. So I really liked it, but again, if you are hard into the sort of period literature and you're worried about accuracy, then these are definitely not the books that you want to read, because they're pure entertainment and it's basically almost like a fantasy version of Great Britain. Like,
right. I mean, I read a lot of stuff like, what is the appeal of these books? And all I could get from anywhere is that they feature very strong, powerful, masculine men who are, on the one hand, like, are extremely strong and are extremely loyal to their clan and will do anything to protect their clan. But they're always sensual lovers, and the woman is supposed to come in and teach them about what love really is. Like, it's in them to be tender, and they just have to draw it out. So it's like, they're the best of the most strong, protective, loyal, good-looking guy with someone who is ultra caring and will do anything for you, pretty much.
Yeah, I agree. I definitely think that would be like the main appeal. I feel in some ways like the characters in the book that I read defied some of those, defied that formula in some ways, because, and I think actually this is true of a lot of the women that, based on the blurbs that I read when I was searching for a book to read, it seems like a lot of the women, English or Scottish, get to be more resourceful and like cunning than they do in a lot of the other romance subgenres. So even though like the, she shows up and looks like kind of a, you know, classic damsel with the bodice ripper and stuff like that. She actually is a really, really good character, Persephone, which is not her real name, which is a big point of mystery. I didn't want to spoil my book too much because it's actually really good.
I think that is true too, besides the man being that perfect man. In my books, like, I think all the heroines in these books also, they're very intelligent. They're very, like you said, resourceful. Like the one, like she knows how to make potions. She's a healer. She studied with her aunt. She comes up with all the plans and the strategy. She helps save her husband when he gets in trouble. The first one, she's very smart and caring and is able to carry out plans and come up with things and always knows what to do. So I think another feature is usually the laird needs to find a husband or a wife, I'm sorry. So the laird needs to find a wife to either, he needs her money or her lands to help his clan, or he needs to have, you know, children or his barns. And they always find, all these women are always more than just that, what they need. They're always somebody who helps them not just learn how to be somebody with manners and how to conduct themselves, but helps not only them and their house, but their clan. So it's more like they always become a partner and helpmate than just, you know, their companion or lover, which I think is pretty much all the ones I've ever read.
That tracks for my books. Yeah. It's like the like sunshine and like grumpy trope, like the women are like, you know, really happy and like caring and loving, like everybody loves them, and then the Highlanders are like, or the Lairds are stoic and like men of few words but very protective, and then, you know, she helps him like fall in love and become a better person, I guess.
I mean, I guess, isn't that part of the fantasy? You have the ultimate fantasy man, and then you have the strong, smart woman who not only gets him and tames him and makes him a better person, but then everybody realizes that how great this woman is for making everything better. So it's an acknowledgement of strong, smart women who can get things done, which is fun.
Yeah, I do. I actually really, as far as a lot of the romance subgenres, I would say this is one that appeals to me more with the way they characterize the protagonists, even though they are unrealistically hot, as they are in many romance subgenres. I would probably read some more Highlander.
They're just fun, mindless, pass the time, enjoyment.
Literary snacks.
All right, well, thank you for joining us for our discussion of Highlander Romance. Join us next time for our discussion on alternate history. See you then.